Welcome back. We're going to start writing now. So I would like you all to reach under your desks, pull out your writing journals and put them on your desks, put a pencil on top of them, and put your hands back down. And I'll wait for you to be ready. Awesome. So we have been doing a reading. We're doing a writing lesson right now. But in reading, we have been reading Home of the Brave and Inside Out and Back Again. And what these books have in common is that they're about a child like you guys. Except these kids are immigrants, and what they're doing is coming to a new land and exploring their identities. They're trying to figure out who they are. And that is something that we will be doing today as a group. By the end of today, we're going to be writing an identity poem where you are going to communicate your experiences and your identity, and you're going to do it with something called concrete language. Talk a lot more about concrete language in a little bit. But first, I want to talk about identity. Can somebody tell me something about who, either, depending on what you're reading, either Hop or Keck? Can you guys tell me something about them?
I think his family was a family of farmers.
So yes, that's something about his identity. Does anybody have something to share about Ha's identity? She is Vietnamese. So good memory that she is from another country. That's awesome. So yes, these are things about their identity. And so when we think about our own identity, we are thinking about what makes us who we are. And so since we're going to focus on identity today, I would like you guys in the back of your writing journal where we have our vocabulary, I would like you to open it up. I would like you to look down, scan down, and find the last entry that you made. Go right below it and write identity. Identity. And remember, this equal sign here means this is how we define it. So your identity is who you are, what makes you who you are. And so that's how I'm going to define identity. I want you to write something in your notebook that will help you remember how you define identity. You write what makes me, or you might have another way to remember. So the things that make you who you are. I want you to take a second while she finishes writing, and I want you to think about what is important to you in your identity. So it could be your family, it could be things about your family, it could be things about your home culture or your school culture. It could be something about what you look like, your hair, your skin, your height. It could be things that you enjoy. These are all parts of your identity. I want you to think about it. I want you to turn to your elbow partner. And since you don't have an elbow partner, Maggie, could you scooch over and share with Julia today? And I want you to share something about your identity.
I think about myself being a big Alaskan a lot. Like, it's been important, but there's just not a lot of people.
Yeah, that would be very fun.
Yeah, for sure.
Things going on up there. So I would like you guys to turn your attention back to me. I love how much you've shared. I heard Austin say that part of his identity is being from Alaska. I heard Julia say that she comes from a big family. These are parts of your identity. These are important things for you. And so authors try to convey identity through words, through language. I'm going to read you a couple of things. Identity poems. Just to get you guys thinking about it, while I'm reading this, I would like you guys to try to come up with two things about, this is about Ha and about her identity, that you can tell me and you can defend with evidence. Remember, we've been working on evidence from the text. So defend it with evidence from the text. Okay? Alright. So, for those of you who are reading Inside Out and Back Again, this is going to be familiar, but listen again with new ears. This poem is called Kim Ha. My name is Ha. Brother Quang remembers I was as red and fat as a baby hippopotamus when he first saw me, inspiring the name Ha Ma, river horse. Brother Vu screams Haya and makes me jump every time he breaks wood or brick in imitation of Bruce Lee. Brother Koi calls me Mother's Tail because I'm always three steps from her. I can't make my brothers go live elsewhere, but I can hide their sandals. We each have but one pair, much needed during this dry season when the earth stings. Mother tells me to ignore my brothers. We named you Kim Ha after the Golden Kim River Ha, where Father and I once strolled in the evenings. My parents had no idea what three older brothers can do with the simple name Ha. Mother tells me, they tease you because they adore you. She's wrong. But I still love being near her, even more than I love my papaya tree. I will offer her its first fruit. So you can hear a lot of things about Kim Ha's identity in that poem, and I hope that you have at least two of them. What I would like you to do with those is I would like you to quickly take them and put them into a box, because we're going to share them in a little bit, but I want you to remember them. And the reason that we're going to do that is because I wanted to give you at least two examples of what to think about. Right now, I am passing out another poem. Sorry if I'm interrupting you. I love that you're writing. This poem isn't going to look like a poem that you're used to. Does this look like a traditional poem?
No.
No. This is from a book called The House on Mango Street by Sandra Cisneros. She is a Latina. She is the children of immigrants, and she writes a lot about her identity. It doesn't look like traditional poetry, but when you hear me read it, I want you to listen to the language that I'm using. That language is why people call this and her style of writing poetry prose. So, be ready again. Try to think of two things that you know about the identity of the speaker. I'm not going to tell you her name yet, because the poem is called My Name. In English, my name means hope. In Spanish, it means too many letters. It means sadness. It means waiting. It is like the number 9, a muddy color. It is the Mexican records my father plays on Sunday mornings when he's shaving, songs like sobbing. It was my great-grandmother's name, and now it is mine. She was a horsewoman too, born like me, in the Chinese year of the horse, which is supposed to be bad luck if you're born female. But I think it's a Chinese lie, because the Chinese, like the Mexicans, don't like their women strong. My great-grandmother, I would have liked to have known her. A wild horse of a woman. So wild, she wouldn't marry until my grandfather threw a sack over her head and carried her off, just like that. As if she was a chandelier. That's the way he did it. And the story goes, she never forgave him. She looked out the window her whole life, the way so many women sit their sadness on an elbow. I wonder if she made the best of what she got, or if she was sorry because she couldn't be all the things she wanted to be. Esperanza, I have inherited her name, but I don't want to inherit her place by the window. At school, they say my name funny, as if the syllables were made out of tin and hurt the roof of her mouth. But in Spanish, my name has is made out of softer something, like silver. Not quite as thick as my sister's name, Magdalena, which is uglier than mine. Magdalena, who at least can come home and be Nanny. But I am always Esperanza. I would like to baptize myself under a new name, a name more like the real me, the one nobody sees. Esperanza is Lissandra, or Maretza, or Zeze the X. Yes, something like Zeze the X will do. So I hope you heard a lot of language that told you about Esperanza's identity in that. What I would like you to do right now is I would like you to think of your two favorite things that you've figured out about people's identity. And when you have something to share, I want you to put your thumb to your chest. If you come up with something really quickly, I want you to start thinking of more things. And each time you think of something new, I want you to put up another finger and see if you can get all five. A couple of thumbs up from waiting for a moment. There we go. I see everybody has some. Everybody has something to share. Oh, some people have more than one thing to share. All right, who would like to share something about one of the characters and their identity? Oh, if you've got your thumbs up, I'm going to be calling on you. Go ahead.
She is a Hispanic girl.
Mm-hmm. So Esperanza is a Hispanic girl, and you know this because.
Her name is a Spanish name, and she references a lot of things about Mexico.
Yeah, she talks about Mexico. So this is something, this is how you know about her identity, the words that she uses to convey her identity. Does anybody have something else?
She's a student.
Mm-hmm.
So she's at school, they say my name funny.
Nice, I like that. Yes. Do you think she likes, oh, hold on. Do you think she likes school? She talks about them saying her name funny?
No.
No. Go ahead.
I like the line that says, "It is the Mexican records my father plays on Sunday mornings," when describing her own name, but it shows us a little bit about her dad.
It does. And I love when she goes on and says that songs that sound like sobbing. Because in my ears, I hear it.
Mm-hmm.
And that is actually a great example of concrete language. Concrete language is something that makes you hear or see or feel what the author is talking about. And that actually leads us really well into what we're going to be doing today, which is writing identity poems using concrete language. And I know that you guys have listened to me talk a lot. I did want to share one more thing with you, just really quickly, because you brought up the sobbing songs, but my son, when I read this to him, could not get over the fact that Pa, because we didn't talk too much about Pa was as red and fat as a baby hippopotamus. He thought that was hilarious. So I wanted to share that with you guys, because I really thought that was funny when he laughed at that. So these words that we're talking about, they paint a picture. You can see that baby hippopotamus, right? That red, fat baby hippopotamus is right there. The sobbing sounds, those are right there. These are concrete words. And I want you guys to have a really excellent understanding of what concrete words are. So I'm going to try to play a clip for you because you've listened to me talk enough. Can I put the screen down or is that?
Yeah.
Can you guys see it without the screen?
It's to the left. If you want to, there's a button on the wall.
Oh, on the wall. Ah, it says screen. Look at that. The button that says screen works the screen. I'm going to go ahead and start it while that's coming down.
What do you mean by concrete words? Good question. Let's consider an example. Suppose you ask what I had for breakfast, and I say food. How helpful have I been? You know I didn't eat rocks or tinfoil or tree bark, but can you picture what I had? Of course not. The term is so general that it includes everything. Concrete terms do just the opposite. They help capture what's individual, unique, and memorable. Like something made of cement, concrete terms give your mind something solid and specific to work with, something you can see, feel, hear, taste, or experience.
Why do I need to use concrete words?
Shoot, I'm sorry, guys. I was trying to get rid of that top bar.
Learn how to improve sentence. What I had for breakfast, and I say food. How helpful have I been? You know I didn't do just the opposite. They help capture what's individual, unique, and memorable.